Welcome to the Women's Wellness Podcast, where we interview experts in various fields with the goal of empowering women to make informed decisions about their health, life, and family. I'm your host, Amy Jane Smith, and I would like to thank you for tuning in today. So get comfy while I introduce our next guest. Hello and welcome to the Women's Wellness Podcast. My name is Amy and I'm your host. And today we are following on from an interview that I had last time in the last episode. If you'd like to watch that, I'll post a link in the show notes. It is episode 25. You can also go to www.connecthealth.fitness/episode25 to listen. The interview did bring up a few questions from people, and I wanted to come and do this episode and tell you a little bit about prolapse and just teach you, give you some information about what a prolapse is, what symptoms can be, and avenues you can go to help heal this prolapse. The idea of this is not to scare anybody, and I know there was a little bit of language in the last interview that may have freaked some people out, and in all honesty, the lady who was being interviewed, she was freaked out by the language that was used. And I'm not saying the language that was used in the interview, but the language that her GP used when she went to see her. And so I wanted to just give you some information, hopefully help you to feel a bit more empowered about what a prolapse is and help you to find the answers you need and the help you need. So let's get going. What is a prolapse? So that's the first question. Now, a prolapse is defined as a lowering, descending of an organ, or a bulging of an organ, such as like a prolapse disc in the spine. In pelvic floor speak, it is when either the bladder or the rectum or the uterus descend into the vagina, or in the case of a man, maybe it comes out of the anus if you get a rectal prolapse. What are the symptoms? So symptoms of a prolapse could be anything from inability to have penetration, and penetration can be inserting tampons, fingers, menstrual cups, sexual aids, having sex like with a male partner, having a penis inside, or examinations, which would be medical instruments. So it could be difficult to insert those into the vagina. You could notice heaviness. Now, Hazel last week mentioned it felt heavy, it felt like things were lowering and things weren't in place. And that is a common description that I've heard from other clients. It just feels like something's dropped, or it just feels a little bit heavy, it just doesn't feel right. It could also feel like it's dragging, and it could affect the way that you go to the toilet. So you could have constipation, you could have incomplete emptying. If you have a bladder prolapse, what that could be, it's a descending and lowering of the bladder, which could push onto the vaginal wall if the vaginal wall is weakened for any reason, or just the heaviness, the weight of the bladder itself when it's full. It could push onto the vaginal wall, and then if you imagine, if I fold my fingers over, this is more of the extremer end. More extreme end, extremer, that's not a word. So if this side is the bladder and the neck of the urethra, and it's falling down, it's falling into the vagina, it could be that this is part of the bladder too, and it's getting urine staying in there and it's not able to empty, it's not able to get over that lump, that ridge, to fully empty. So you might notice that maybe you're dribbling later and you're not able to fully empty. So some people, they do put their fingers into the vagina and hold up the wall to help empty. Same goes for a rectal prolapse. It could fall again down, it could descend, it could start to fall and press against the vaginal wall, and then it could block the vaginal wall, it could get in the way, and feces could build up here. And again, that is not going to be able to go out, so you might need to just push up and push everything out. Things, so grading. Let's go with grading. I don't like to grade too much because people do get caught up on it. It's sometimes something that a physiotherapist, a women's health, pelvic health physiotherapist will check, and they might mentally grade it, but they might not tell you. They will give you different descriptions. Everyone's different. Some people don't like to describe it because it can, you can get caught up with a number. Don't get caught up with a number. Everything is, I don't want to say fixable, but there is a way of treating different kinds of prolapse. So don't get caught up on the number and think that's it, I'm a level 4 and there's nothing that can be done. Something can always be done to a degree. Okay, so it is graded 0 to 4. 0 means that there is no prolapse. Everything is where it should be. Level one is when things to start, they start falling in and they're just starting to kind of push into the vagina, just starting to lower. For example, the cervix could lower as well, or the uterus could lower. I didn't mention that before, but they could lower as well and start to drop down a little bit. So within a couple of centimeters down. Then we have a level 2 prolapse, which is when the organs are pushing down and they're coming down and they are within a couple of centimeters of the opening of the vagina. Next, you have a level 3, which is just around the opening to within a couple of centimeters out of the vagina. And then a level 4 is when everything's kind of turned inside out and it's completely out of the vagina. And this is where I wanted to note the comment that the GP mentioned to Hazel in the interview. She went to see her GP after the midwife had kind of gone, oh yeah, whatever, give it 6 weeks, you'll be fine. In the meantime, she's going, what on earth do I do in the meantime, kind of thing. So she went to the GP, and the GP's language was scary. There's no way of skirting around that. It was scary language, and it's not something I would recommend saying to anybody who is concerned about the placing of their internal organs. So Hazel had gone to the GP with already this preconceived notion that a prolapse is going to ruin her life. Her grandma had several children, had repair surgery, and was in pain for the rest of her life with it. And obviously that's many, many years ago. Things have changed and moved on and progressed since then, but that was the story she had. So she was already worried, yeah? Then she went to this GP. The GP checked and went, oh yeah, that's a bad prolapse. Instantly, that is going to stress somebody out, okay? It's not the right phrasing. Noticing that there's a prolapse, having a poker face is always good as a clinician, and then you use your words wisely. Then she tried to play it down by saying, oh, don't worry, I had I know a woman in her 70s whose uterus fell out on the golf course and she's fine now. That makes it sound like she was putting on the green and had a cough and had to pick a vagina uterus up off the floor. That would never happen. Never. That would never happen. It might be that she notices prolapse. Maybe she, I don't know what led to this woman having a prolapse, but something happened to cause a final bit of pressure and a final kind of pop and lowering. And the uterus might have come out. It might have been a grade 4 prolapse, which meant that she would have needed surgery. But it wasn't like she had to pick up her uterus and pop it in her golf bag and head to A&E. It just sounds a bit ridiculous, and it's not a story that you should tell a client or a patient who is concerned about things like that happening. So yeah, let's say even if you do get a grade 4 prolapse, which is when it can't go any further, it is completely out, there are things that can happen. And your undies would support still. Go to the doctor, get them to refer you, or go to the hospital. You don't want that to be, it'll get uncomfortable, it won't be pleasant for you. So you'd need to go to the A&E, go and get that sorted, and they can stitch it in place. They don't do mesh anymore, or at least I don't think they do. I'm sure somebody will correct me if I've said that wrong. But they can put everything back in place, and they can stitch back, and they can kind of re-support ligaments and things like that to make sure everything's stitched in place, and then scar tissue builds around those stitches, and they hold it in place again. So that is level 4. Level 3 is fairly similar. You would probably need surgery to help fix that and put everything back in place. Level 2 and level 1, you can support the symptoms, you can alleviate symptoms with lifestyle management. And that is essentially what Hazel did in the last interview. She went to the doctor, I think she went for a second opinion. The doctor referred her to a physio at the hospital, and the physio checked her, made sure she could do the squeezes and relax, and then she gave her homework to help get that part down, get it right in the head, make sure you could actually feel that connection. Then she went on to write, can you do this standing up and sitting down? So she went through all of that with her. It helped her to build up confidence in herself. So then she was able to come and see me and progress into learning how to connect and do those squeeze and lifts and relax whilst moving, so she could live a full life and actually carry and hold her baby again, which is something that she wasn't able to do without fear. So that really is what a prolapse is in a nutshell. What I recommend, oh, pessaries. I didn't mention pessaries before I go, but I didn't mention pessaries. You can get a pessary fitted. Some physios are qualified to do it, pelvic floor physios. Some will refer you to a gynecologist. It's like being fitted if you've ever had a diaphragm fitted, the contraception little thing that sits over your cervix. Then it's kind of like that. Everyone's a different size, everyone's a slightly different shape. Not everything fits everyone. So what they can do is they can fit a pessary, which you would insert, and it will hold things in place. And that is really good to use whilst you're learning how to rehabilitate your pelvic floor muscles to help get everything in place, how to manage your breathing, how to manage lifestyle factors that could cause symptoms to appear. What I do, so I always, if it is a prolapse that needs a clinical intervention, then I do recommend that you go and see somebody like that first. And I have a directory in my on my website. So if you go to connecthealth.fitness/directory, you'll be able to find a New Zealand-based women's health, pelvic floor health physiotherapist, and they can assess you and give you some exercises to make sure that you can feel when you're tightening and when you're relaxing. Because that's the first step. Once you've got that, then you can come and see me and we can go through lifestyle management, syncing that to how you breathe and making sure that when you are living life, you're not holding your breath and you're not bearing down on those pelvic floor muscles or organs. If you'd like to know more, then I will post a link to a free discovery call. You can book in and we can have a chat and I can listen to your story and just see where it is that you would need to go. I can see if you can feel the pelvic floor contraction with cueing only, or again, if you would need to see a physio. In an ideal world, a physio would be the first port of call, but sometimes it's not for everyone. There might not be one close by, so there are other options available. It just might take a little bit longer if you can't feel that connection. So that is a little bit of information about prolapse, what it is, what the symptoms are, and where to go for help. I hope that's helped. Please comment below in either the YouTube video or wherever you are listening to it. Please give me a review on the app that you are listening, and I would love to hear from anybody else who has had a prolapse and listen to your story as well, because everybody is different and the more variety we have, then the more it will help other people. So thank you, have a great day, and I will chat to you in the next podcast. Bye. Thank you for listening to the Women's Wellness Podcast. For links and show notes, please visit www.connecthealth.fitness/podcast. I would love for you to subscribe to the channel so you get notified when we release our next episode, and please share with anyone you think might benefit. Thank you again. I look forward to seeing you soon.